Okay, so let's start for today. So today we are planning to go for the three hands-on. The first one we'll be checking configuring the rack awareness on Hortonworks data platform. So we'll be configuring creating a rack topology script, and using the script we would be utilizing and copying within the Hadoop configuration directory for the cluster nodes. We need to run the rack topology shell script to ensure that it returns to the correct rack information for each and every host. And in the next step, we need to add the topology script property to the core site.xml, specifically for property settings. And after restarting the HDFS and MapReduce services, we could be able to verify the rack awareness services on Hortonworks cluster. So the steps for this that we need to do is basically, first should be able to create a rack topology script. So here in this step, we need to create basically two topology script. Like one should be a sample topology script that could have the specific configurations on rack prefix, Hadoop configuration file details, and specifically it should consist of the logics, like if Hadoop configuration file is being specified to the specific file, then it should echo to the rack prefix and the rack number. So we have been configuring some if-else conditions over the shell script file, and the file is I have right now with me, and another file that we need to write. So this file should be named as rack topology.sh, and another file that should be a data file, that rack topology data file. So just make sure the topology script, that should be always executable. So we just need to make it executable first, and we should have also a sample topology data file. And this file should be named as racktopology.data. And after that, we need to copy both of these files to this conf directory on all of the cluster node, and number D, we need to run the rack topology shell to ensure that it returns the correct rack information for each host. This is step number one. In step number two, need to add the topology script property to core site.xml. So first we need to stop the services. Stop HDFS. Just need to add some configuration file, some configuration over core site.xml. Then we need to restart once again HDFS and MapReduce. And next, we can verify the rack awareness feature. Since we'll be performing on Sandbox, so it will be a single node cluster. So if you're going to do in the multi-node environment, suppose in the cloud environment we have three some master VMs and four or more than that slave VMs, and we are configuring rack owners over there. So we should be very beautifully, we could be able to see the specific Hadoop FSCK command. We would be able to see each and every rack status information, like node status information, whether the status is in healthy node or healthy status or not, total size, total directories, total files, what are the total blocks that should be validated, minimum replicated blocks, over replicated blocks, under replicated blocks, average block replication, corrupted blocks, missing replicas, number of data nodes, that's all the information should be visible. And also we could be able to utilize these types of scripts, HDFS, DFS admin report. So which could be just would return specifically a report that could include then each and every rack name next to each and every machine name. So this report should be look like something that would have the informations like total configuration capacity of the rack, present capacity in terabyte, DFS, how many blocks have been DFS in remaining, how many percentage of DFS blocks that has been utilized, under replicated blocks, blocks with corrupted replicas, missing blocks, how many data nodes being available, each and every data nodes name, host name, rack name, decommissioning status, configuring capacity, DFS, non-DFS, DFS remaining, caching capacity, that would be visible. So let's start with the first step. So I have the script with me that's called as racktopology.sh. So here the script is being consist of specifically the features regarding Hadoop configuration directory name, that etc Hadoop slash conf, which is specific to HTTP 2.2, the CTL file, which is a specific CTL file, that's a data file, a rack topology data file that you need to provide to the cluster, rack underscore topology dot data. And specifically to test, we need to supply a host name as a script input. Then we can specify the execute this corresponding logic. Here is a while loop is also has been given for executing based on the Hadoop configurations and this data file. And it would check one by one lines, and it would be based on this array values that's being matching to this node argument. Then it will the result would be showing up. So based on the specific details and based on the logic that if the result is being matching, so it could show up the rack prefix slash the rack number, it would being verified with the if else block in the shell. So this shell script we have to be passed through the Hortonworks cluster. So let's create this file. So I have just pasted this file. Save and exit. Next, I need to create another file that could called the sample topology data file. Here also, I need to mention the following configuration settings. This file should be Since I have in the sandbox just only a single cluster, so I'm mentioning only the single IPs and the location. So when you're working in the production clusters, you have multiple node address and the location, so you just need to mention all of the host IPs and the rack location correspondingly. Now we just need to copy both of these files to the directory, that etc Hadoop conf directory. So we have run this racktopology.sh script to ensure that it returns the correct rack information for each and every host. So since right now it's a single node sandbox, so it's just returning the single rack information. Next, we need to stop the HDFS services. So HDFS services has been stopped. Now we need to add some property configurations in core site.xml. Just open core site.xml. So the following property needs to be added. So the name would be net.topology.script.file.name, and since we have copied the following file, that's rack.topology.shell, so that file just needs to be copied, and after copying we just need to add the following property in core site.xml. So by default the topology script will process up to 100 requests per invocation. So you can also specify a different numbers of requests with this net.topology.script.number.arguments property. For example, if you want to pass suppose 75 requests per invocation, so you can add a property like this. So that type of property that could be added, because by default the script would be processed up to 100 requests, but a specific numbers of requests can be also processed if we want to specify in the configuration file itself. So we can save and exit. Next we need to restart once again the HDFS and MapReduce services. So to start the services, what we need to do, we need to start first MapReduce services, and then we need to start the HDFS services. So HDFS services has been stopped already. Go for a name node format first. Remember, in HTTP we can format the name node. We can start and stop the name node daemons, data node daemon, and secondary name node daemon. Any services that can be stopped and started based on using the following command, that we need to run this commands for starting and stopping using the corresponding service as admin user. So if you are working on HDFS starting and stopping, we just need to make sure the command should be run as the HDFS admin user. If you are starting and stopping MapReduce, so the corresponding services should be started or executed with MapReduce as admin user. So both HDFS and MapReduce services, YARN services, that has been restarted. Now we can verify the rack awareness feature. So after the services has been started, we can use the following the methods that I am going to do. That's to utilize to verify the rack awareness has been activated. So we just need to look at the name node logs that could be located within. This location, that var log Hadoop HDFS. So there, here we are able to see the following logs files being available. That's a typically, that's for as an example, like the log files looks like Hadoop-HDFS-namenode-sandbox.log. And there could be an entry in each and every log file that could have the specific log information regarding from name node, secondary name node, and data node itself. And as you can see, there are pretty some logs files being available, like as Hadoop HDFS name node.sandbox.hortonworks.com.out, and there is one log file is being available as Hadoop.hdfs.namenode.sandbox.hortonworks.com.log. So if we just need to, if we just go and verify these logs files, what type of entry has been here in these log files? So here in this logs files, we'll be able to see that there are some entries has been there that has been mentioned as a starting name node, a startup message, when the name node has been started, and the IP address, some startup message arguments, and the version of the Hadoop, because we have just formatted earlier the name node. And after doing this, we have been checked this the log files details. Similarly, if we just go ahead and check with this fsck command, so typically this fsck command, it should return, like if suppose there are two racks is being working, one as name node, one as a data node. So in this point, if we execute the fsck command, it should show us the status, the rack health status, total size, total directories, total files, total blocks, and minimally replicated blocks, over replicated blocks. Those details could be available. Similarly, we could be able to run the Hadoop DFS report command, DFS admin report command, that could return typically a report that includes a rack name next to each and every machines. So we could execute DFS to DFS admin. So it could be able to show us the configured capacity for HDFS, the present capacity in sizes, DFS, total DFS that had been utilized, missing blocks, blocks with corrupted replicas, data nodes available, how many data nodes being there, the IP address for each and every data nodes, the host name, rack information, that's all the specific details that could be available there. Okay, the name node is being working now. So what is the issue that I had here? I had the name node was not starting. So name node failure issue has happened. And there was a typically while I was formatting name node, I was able to see the reason behind the issue. So it was not able to delete the current folder that is being created inside the name node directory, name node slash current, specifically the version file which I mentioned earlier as well, that inside the name node and a data node, all the time whenever we are formatting and after we are working on with a name node and data node, so there has been each and every formatting time a version file has been created. So next time when we are making any changes over name node or data node, you just need to delete that version file, whether it's for data node or whether it's for name node, which is present inside the current directory. So what you can do, you can either specifically remove the current directory itself, or either you can remove the version file. The version file actually consists of the specifically file logs and file edit checking information, which next time after formatting, it just creates an issue while starting the services, because it just keeps back the earlier synchronization state of the previous status of that service. So while in that real life, whenever we face such issues like name node is not starting up, data node is not starting up, or sometimes secondary name node is failed to start up, we specifically need to check for those of the files, that if that specifically those files create the issues or not. If those files are specifically the reason behind the issues, most of the cases 80% issues are being created by the version file itself, because it just holds the previous status logs and information. So just delete that file itself or delete the directory. So it would be, because each time whenever you are formatting the name node, each time a new fresh current directory would be created with a new version file. So if the previous version file is existing, so at that time it just creates an issue as well. So delete those earlier old version file. Just go ahead and check the name node, format the name node, and start the services freshly. So this two command we are executed because to verify the rack awareness on HTTP. So in the first command, what we did, we just checked with this Hadoop DFS admin report command that could return specifically a report includes a rack name next to each and every machine. Since a single node cluster, in the single cluster itself, in the sandbox, we have name node, data node, and secondary name node all has been configured, and we have not configured specifically any capacity for name node, data node, or DFS specifically. So that's why the values are here. It's all zeros, but in real time, whenever we have been working with multiple masters and slave clusters in a single rack, or specifically in the numbers of nodes that's been configured in a single rack for masters and slave nodes, so there specifically whenever we run this command, we would be able to see that the total configured capacity, like total numbers of blocks, suppose maybe 20 terabytes or 50 terabytes, present capacity, that's maybe under 20 terabytes if it is total configured capacity, present capacity might be around 16.5 terabytes, DFS remaining blocks, DFS utilized blocks, under replicated blocks if it is anywhere, any under replicated blocks are present, if any missing blocks are present, mostly it should be zero, how many data nodes being available, the names, like IP addresses for those data nodes, host name, rack information. So that's each and every details that could be available for those. And similarly, like if we wanted to check, like in another command, like FSCK command, that should, if we just check like between the two racks, as I said, we have specifically some of the log files being available, name node log files, which is located within var log Hadoop slash HDFS. And there has been several examples of log files like Hadoop HDFS, name node sandbox.hotonworks.com. Dot logs. So we should be in this logs files if we check, so we should be able to see some of the entries. Some of the entries like this, starting message, then host name, IP addresses, arguments, version number, then status information. Now if we check after coming out this, if we come out from this log file, if we check normally with FSCK command, so normally that HDFS FSCK that would return specifically the status information that should be returned, like if there are two racks, so what are the health status of two racks, what are the total size, what are the total directories, what are the total files that's being present, how minimally replicated blocks, over replicated blocks, that's all the information that should be available from there. Similarly, if you want to check with from Ambery portal, if you want to check the specific details, like service HDFS service matrices, total space utilization, file operation, block status, HDFS IO JVM thread status, garbage collections, and RPC values, so you'd be able to do that. For quick configuration sections in the configs tab, if you just go ahead and check out the values for the specific configurations, like for configuring Kerberos, configuring the high availability on the name nodes. So each and every details that could be available in the config section for each and every services, like for name node, for secondary name node, for data node, in general, Hadoop policy files, Hadoop environment files, advanced core site.xml files. So with a specific Hadoop security configurations, that what we have done yesterday, the security configurations, fs.defaultfs, because default it's listening to the port number 8020 for the name node, fs trash interval, Hadoop HDFS authentication, Hadoop security authorization if you want to make it, IO file buffer sizes, IO serializations, that's all the details that could be available here. Similarly, custom Hadoop policy, custom HDFS.site. So here also we need to make some specific configurations over there. So that also you can do directly from Ember itself instead of doing it from terminal in the core site.xml or HDFS site.xml. So that's typically was the demo that's based on the rack awareness verification and configurations of rack awareness on HTTP. The next demo where we will be discussing about configuring Kerberos security and how to prepare Kerberos, how to install and configure KDC, Kerberos distribution configurations, creating the Kerberos database and start the Kerberos database configurations that we will be doing so far. So typically for Kerberos, so Kerberos is, as an overview standpoint, it's just being utilized to establish the identity with strong authentication that could be the basis for secure access in Hadoop, and users that need to identify themselves and then have to that this identity that needs to be propagated throughout the Hadoop cluster, because user need to be able to reliably identify themselves, and then that that should identify the propagated throughout the Hadoop cluster itself. So once this is done, those users can access to, some specific resources such as files or directories, or they can interact with the cluster like running MapReduce jobs as well. And Hadoop cluster resources themselves, such as host and services, they also need to authenticate with each other to avoid the potential malicious systems which is posing as a part of the cluster to gain access to the data. So in order to create a secure communications among the various components, Hadoop uses Kerberos. Kerberos is typically a third-party authentication mechanism. We already discussed about Knox gateway for typical secure way authentication authorization. Knox is typically a high-level security concepts. Kerberos is a basic level security which is typically was prevalent at, from till now as a Hadoop security mechanism. Knox basically is a very new platform, as just a young platform, but Kerberos has been there till the incubation phase of Hadoop. So it is a process, it's a third-party authentication mechanism in which users and services that users want to access that rely on some third party, the Kerberos server. So the Kerberos server helps to authenticate each to other. Kerberos server itself is known as a key distribution center or KDC. And at the high level, the key distribution center of Kerberos, it consists of three parts. One is a database of the users and services, which is known as principles, that it knows about and their respective Kerberos passwords. Number two, it also consists of an authentication server, which is called AS, which performs the initial authentication, and it helps to issue a ticket granting ticket, which is called TGT. And number three component is a ticket granting server of Kerberos, that's called TGS, that typically issues subsequent service tickets based on initial TGT. So a user principle typically it requests the authentication from authentication server. The authentication server typically returns a ticket gateway ticket, ticket granting ticket, the TGT. So TGT that is encrypted and using the user principle's Kerberos password, which is known only to the user principle and the authentication server. The user principle that typically decrypts the TGT, the ticket granting ticket, locally by using the its Kerberos password, and from that point forward until the ticket expires, the user principle can use the TGT to get the service tickets from the TGS, ticket granting services. The service tickets are what allow the principal to access the various services, because cluster resources like host or services, it cannot provide a password each time to decrypt the TGT. So typically it uses a special file that's called keytab, which contains the resource principal's authentication credentials. So in order to set the host, a set of host, typically the corresponding the entire set of host users or services over which Kerberos server has control is called a realm. So it's a term called realm. It's a set of host users and services over which the Kerberos server has control. So there are some typical terminologies that are available. One is called Kerberos Distribution Center or KDC. So KDC is a trusted source for authentication. Trusted source for authentication in a Kerberos enabled environment. Number B, that's Kerberos KDC server. So Kerberos KDC server is a machine or server that serves as a key distribution center. Number C is a Kerberos client. Kerberos client is typically any machine in the cluster that authenticates against the KDC. Number D is the principal. So this is the unique name of the user or service that authenticates against the KDC. Next comes keytab. So keytab is typically a file that includes one or more principals and their keys. And number F is a realm. Realm stands for the Kerberos network that includes a KDC and a number of clients. So here goes next some of the steps that how to install and configure Kerberos distribution center, that's Kerberos KDC. So typically to use the Kerberos with Hadoop, you can either use an existing KDC or you can install a new one for Hadoop's usage, and there are some high-level descriptions being available for the installation purpose. I will provide that each and every server-specific documentation, like whether for RHEL there is a specific documentation, for CentOS there is a specific, and Cells is a specific one. So Kerberos is it's a time-sensitive protocol, so all the hosts in the realm that must be time-synchronized. Just for an example, like by using network time protocol, NTP, If the local system time of a client differs from that of the KDC by as little as 5 minutes default, so in that cases also the client will not be able to authenticate. So the first command is to install a new version of Kerberos server. So I'm doing it in the sandbox itself. We just need to install a new version first of Kerberos server on RHEL, CentOS or Oracle Linux. We just need to execute this command. KRB5 server, KRB5 libs, KRB5 auth dialog. So this command would install a new version of Kerberos server. So by default you can enable the Kerberos security from Ambery portal itself. So if you go to Ambery, so under the admin tab you'd get an option called security, and there you'd be able to see that the security tab, and it should be mentioned as Kerberos security is disabled by default. If you click on enable security, so it would open an enable security wizard, that where you can install, configure and start the Kerberos KDC. You can install, configure Kerberos client on every host in the cluster, and you could be able to create Kerberos principal for Hadoop services and host, and you could be able to generate the key tabs for each principal and place on the appropriate host. So before doing this, we need to prepare, just go through the manual steps that what we are doing on terminal, and be sure that we need to also record these locations of the key tab files for each and every host and principals for the Hadoop services. So after enabling through manually this all the services like installations of Kerberos KDC and installation and configuring the Kerberos client, then creating after the Kerberos principals for Hadoop services and host, we could be able to do it directly from Ambery portal. We could be enable the security wizard itself. Next, so since the server has installed Kerberos server, so we need to edit the configuration file. Just need to open in the editor. We just need to change the realm sections of this file by replacing the default default kerberos.example.com. With the full qualified name of the KDC server, so that whatever have been mentioned here, the default as kerberos.example.com, so which is setting for the KDC and admin server properties, for the just need to be replaced with a FQDN, the fully qualified domain name of the KDC server. So here, suppose I'm replacing with, for example, with my.kdc.server and admin server as well. I'm replacing with my.kdc.server. So it has to be replaced with actual FQDN of the KDC server. No more configuration is needed after this. And next, we need to create the database. So we just need to use the utility of kdb5_util to create the Kerberos database. So typically for Rails, CentOS, or Oracle, we can use this following command. So the hyphen s option that would store the master server key for the database in the stash file, and if the stash file is not present, so you must go ahead and log into the KDC with the master password specified during the installation each time whenever it would be starting. Next, we can start the KDC. If you are working on cells, on SUSE, so you can alternatively you can execute rckrb5kdc start and rckadmind start. So we have started the services for KDC. Next, we need to install and configure the Kerberos clients as well. So as usual for Rails, CentOS, or Oracle Linux, we just need to do this by using yum and just need to install Kerberos client. KRB5 workstation. And next, you just need to copy that krb5.conf file to all of the host and cluster. In the next step, we need to create the service principles and key type files for Hadoop 2.x. So typically, each service and subservice in Hadoop that must have its own principle now. So a principle name that in a given realm that should consist of a primary name and an instance name. So which in this case that could be an FQDN, full qualified domain name of the host that should return the service. Now as a service that do not log in with a password to acquire their tickets, so their principal's authentication credentials that could be stored in the KeyTab file, which needs to be extracted from the Kerberos database, and it would be stored locally with the service principal on the service component host. First, you need to create the principal using the mandatory naming convention, and then you must create the KeyTab file with the principal's information and just copy the file to the KeyTab directory on the appropriate service host. So just one thing to note here, principals can be created either on KDC machines itself or through some network. So by using an admin principal, the following instruction that would be the commands that would be executed, that could assume that you are going to use a KDC machine, and that could be using the kadmin.local command line administration utility. Now using the kadmin.local on the KDC machine, that could allow you to create the principals without needing to create a separate admin principal before you start. So in this KDC machine, we need to open the kadmin.local utility. In user has been kadmin local, so specifically we need to open this kadmin.local utility on the KDC machine, and we just need to create some service principles. So the service principle that needs to be written like this way. Add principal. Rand key, random key. Primary name slash fully qualified domain dot name at example.com. So the rand key option that would be used to generate the password actually, and here in this example, like each and every service principal's primary name that needs to be appended to the instance name and the FQDN of the host in which it runs. So that should provide a unique principal name for the services, that it could be run on multiple hosts like data nodes and node managers, and the additions of the host name servers that needs to be distinguished. Just like for example, to request from data node A from a request from data node B, this is important for two reasons. Like if the Kerberos credential for one data node are compromised, so it doesn't automatically lead to all the data node security that is being compromised. In case suppose if multiple data nodes have exactly the same principal and are simultaneously connecting to the name node, and if the Kerberos authenticator being sent happens to have same timestamp, so in that cases also then the authentication would be rejected as a replay request. So there are some service principles that's being there. Like for HDFS, we have the similar components like name node, the mandatory principal name that should be for name node slash FQDN for the name node. For HDFS component like a name node HTTP, mandatory principal name would be HTTP slash FQDN of that of service. For secondary name node, we have name node slash FQDN of secondary name node. If similarly, we have the services like secondary name node HTTP, data node, history server for MapReduce, a Yarn for resource manager, node manager, Uzi for Uzi server, like this. In addition, you must create the four special principles for AmberEase as well for users, like AmberEase principles, like for AmberEase user, AmberEase smoke test user, like AmberEase-QA, AmberEase HDFS user, that's called HDFS, and AmberEase HBase user, that's HBase. So alternatively, you could, once the principles has been created, you could, in the database we have already created, now you could extract the related key tab files for transferring those appropriate host. So in this kadmin.local, could be able to add the following. Key tab, file name, primary name, it's fully qualified domain name, example.com. So you must use these mandatory names for this key tab file, whatever the variables that could be shown in this table. And in some older cases, like some older versions of Kerberos, they don't support this XST, the non-rand key option. In that case, you can use the command without the no rand key flag, except that in some of the cases where you need to copy a principle from one key tab file to another key tab file in the host. And that should be, must be our requirement, like for the Hadoop configurations on the host, where have the key tab path properties that could point to the different key tab locations, but the corresponding principal name properties that have the same values. So in the situations, like, you may use the two step, like kadmin slash kutil procedure. So that could be assumes that they, you are having a MIT Kerberos. So if you are using some another version, you can check the corresponding Kerberos documentation for this. So suppose if in order to create a key tab file for name node HTTP, you can write kadmin.local xst no random key and k service dot key tab HTTP, just mention the name node host. So if you are having, suppose, a large cluster, so you may want to create a script to automate the creating your principles and key tabs. To help with that, you can download a CSV formatted file where all of the required principal names and the key tab files will be there from the AmberEase web GUI. So just, you just go ahead with AmberEase portal, go to the security, enable security, and run the enable security wizard. Using all the default values, you'd be able to get the create principles and key tabs, and you can download as those as the CSVs. So when this key tab files has been created on each and every host, just create a directory for them and set the appropriate permissions. Like, we need to create a directory like this way. Skip the permission. Chmod 750 TC security key tabs. Next step, we need to copy the appropriate key tab file to each and every host. So if a host, suppose, runs more than one component file, for example, like both node manager and data node, all are running in the same. So just need to copy the key tabs for both of the components. So the AmberEase smoke test user, like AmberEase-QA or AmberEase HDFS user or AmberEase HBase user key tabs, that should be copied to all the necessary hosts on the cluster. or if you have some customized service usernames, or just replace them with the default values with the appropriate service user groups or key tab names. So just need to set up the appropriate permissions as well. Make sure that the file has been copied. So if you are getting this message like invalid user AmberyAmbery, so make sure that you just need to set up the Kerberos JS configuration for Ambery as well. Kerberos JS configuration is typically if you want to set up the JS configuration for Ambery, that's independent access to the native Hadoop GUIs, like the name node UIs that could be a secure, and Ambery Apache community docs that could be provide a vast information to set up the configurations and then to the following. So what we need to do basically, we just need to run the some setup commands and we just need to answer the following prompts over there. So what we need to do for this to set up the Kerberos JS configuration for Ambery. So we just need to run the following command, Ambery server setup security. So it could prompt you different options to set up the Ambery Kerberos JS configuration. For one, it would be HTTPS for Ambery server, 2 to enable HTTPS for Ganglia service, 3 for enable HTTPS for NagUS service, 4 to encrypt password stored in the Ambery properties file, and setup 5 is to set up the Ambery Kerberos JS configuration. So since we are want to enable Ambery Kerberos JS configuration, so giving the option 5, and it would be asked for Ambery server's Kerberos principal name. I'm giving the default one. Thank you. Okay, I'm assuming providing the absolute path itself. So next step is basically after providing the key absolute path, we need to restart the Ambari server, that Ambari server restart option, so that we could be able to set up the Kerberos JS configuration for Ambari itself. And after it has been there, so we could be able to execute the command that's to give the permission within ambari.keytab file, and optionally you could provide the permissions for etc security keytab / ambari keytab. Similarly, if we have this key tabs for HDFS name nodes and security name nodes also, we need to give the similar set of permissions, like for HDFS, for example, like HDFS user and group for Hadoop, we just need to write ch own HDFS colon Hadoop, then we need to mention the directory, that key tabs etc security key tabs / name node dot service dot key tab. Similarly, on the HDFS name node host also, for the Ambari test user like Ambari-QA, we just need to provide the set of information. Similar this way, we just need to give the permissions for yarn resource manager, yarn node manager on the host that runs Uzi server, on the host which runs Hive Metastore, Hive server 2, Web HCAT, on the host that runs HBase master server, region server, and Zookeeper, or the host that runs NagiWare server. So everywhere, we just need to give the permissions. Just go ahead first giving the permissions with the following user and the group, and next to just provide to make it executables, like give the permission chmod 400, and verify that with the correct keytab files and the principles are associated with the correct service. So just using the klist command, klist k. Suppose after giving permission on each and every host, so just need to execute keytabs / name node dot service dot keytab. So you just need to execute then each and every respective services. Just need to execute the klist command. So this is the step by how we could be able to create the service principal and keytab files for Hadoop 2.x. And after that, we have already discussed about creating the mappings between the principals and the Unix usernames. So next step is basically to enable the Kerberos security. So after doing all of the manual execution, can go ahead to Ambari, and we could be able to enable the Kerberos security here. So here, after clicking on next, you could be in the configure services to configure Kerberos security principles. You could be able to get the specifications, like for Ambari smoke test user principle, in this user like Ambari-QA, the path to the smoke test user keytab file has been present in etc security keytabs, smoke user.headless.keytab. HDFS user permissions keytab would be there. HBase user principal specific keytab files would be there. And similarly, if you check for the other services, like for HDFS, for HTTP host, for general name node, secondary name node, data node, for MapReduce 2, we'll be able to see the history server host, the principal name, the path to the keytab file, web principal name, and path to the SPNGO keytab file for MapReduce. For yarn services, you could be able to find for the resource manager, the principal name and its keytab file, web principal name for resource manager and its specific Kerberos authorized SPNGO keytab file. For node manager, there will be the principal names and it's the principal keytab file, web principal name and path to the SPNGO keytab files, node manager, container executor class name. Application timeline services, that could consist of the yarn host name, path to the app timeline server keytab file, and path to the application timeline server SPNGO HTTP keytab file. Similarly, if you just go ahead and check for each and every service, similarly for NagUS, its service GitHub file, for Hive, its service GitHub file, its HBase, its GitHub files. If you check for Uzi, you'd be able to see its corresponding GitHub file. For Zookeeper, you'd be able to see its GitHub files would be there. Falcon, it should have its corresponding GitHub files would be there. Like same directory, specifically user security, GitHubs, Falcon service.github, web principal name and path to the Kerberos authorized SP NGO GitHub file, and also for Storm. Storm is very specific to HTTP 2.2. So once it's being confirmed, you can click on next. So it would go ahead and create the principles and GitHub. So you can also optionally download the CSV file. So it would be consist of the CSV file would be used to set up the script, and the list should include the host name, principal description, principal name, the GitHub user, GitHub group, GitHub permissions, absolute GitHub path, and the GitHub file name. So all the details would be applicable here. So next you should be able to save and apply the configuration. So the step would be display a bar showing the progress of integrating the Kerberos information to the Ambry server. So next you can just go ahead and click on apply. So it would stop the services, it would save the configurations, and then it would start the services once again. Just to show up the progress on integrating the Kerberos information into the Ambry server.
Hey Ananda.
Yeah.
The file that I saved yesterday's recording, I was not able to upload it to the OneDrive. Do you need to give any specific permissions, write permissions for me on the drive?
I think you were the organizer, so can you please convert this to the MP4 with GoToMeeting?
No, I did. I did convert it and it is saved in my desktop here, but I'm not able to upload it to OneDrive.
Okay. In that case, this might be I have only the permission issue that to uploading. Just give me 1 second. Let me give you access. What's your mail ID?
S-V-A-N-N-A-L-A. V-A-N-N-A-L-A. At yahoo.com.
Oh, please check if this is the correct one I typed.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. So I've given you the permissions to edit so that you could be able to upload this one.
Okay. You're going to ask email ID and password?
Not connect. Password. You would get an email as well, like I have shared with you.
Okay.
Otherwise, okay. I'm pasting in the chat window as well, this link.
Okay.
This is the link. Yeah, this link you can use. You would be able to access and you would be able to upload as well because I've given you editing permission as well.
Yeah, I got the email.
Okay.
Thanks.
All right, so the next demo that would be based on configuring the Nimnode high availability cluster. So basically these are the few steps for this configuration, like we need to deploy a Nimnode IHA cluster. So in order to deploy a Nimnode IHA cluster, there are some options like configure Nimnode HA cluster. So typically it's this is for adding the high availability configuration to your HDFS configuration file, so that you could be able to start by talking to HDFS configuration file from the original name node in your HTTP cluster, and you could be able to use that as a base. So adding the properties mentioned below, so you just need to add some property configurations for this in the HDFS site.xml. So this property configuration should be set based on DFS dot name services. So we just need to choose an arbitrary but a logical name. For example, my cluster or the sandbox.hotmail.com as a value of DFS dot name services option. And this name would be used for both configurations and authority component for absolute HDFS path in the cluster. So just going forward. Move back to HDFS site.xml and add this following property. Add the following property as property name DFS name server, sorry, name services. And the value should be, you can give any specific value for the cluster, so I'm giving it as sandbox.toolbox.com. Close out the property. So if you are also using HDFS Federation, so this configuration setting should include the list of other services like high availability like HA or otherwise a comma separated list. The next configuration that needs to be done, like it would be based on DFS.HA.NameNodes, should based on name services ID, which should provide a list of comma separated name node IDs. Like data node should use this property to determine that all of the name nodes in the cluster. So for example, for the name nodes ID like my cluster or sandbox.hotmail.com, and the individual name nodes ID are supposed NN1 and NN2, so this value of this property will be like this. Property name DFS.HA.NameNode. Autonomous.com is the name of the property. So currently a maximum of two name nodes may be configured by name services. And also another, we just need to use a property to specify the full qualified RPC address for each name node to listen on. So continuing with this, the previous one, just we have seen the full address and IPC port of name node process for the two name node IDs like name node 1 and name node 2. So note that suppose there will be two separate configuration options are there, like for RPC address dot sandbox.hotmail.com.nn1, that's for the first name node. If we are having, considering we have two different name nodes, and another one that could be property could be dfs.namenode.rpcaddress.mycluster.namenode2. So if we configure for two different name nodes, so I just need to write this following property set. like property name DFS dot name node dot RPC address my cluster or sandbox.hotmogs.com whatever first name node value should be full qualified name of this host machine example.com 8020 for this case sandbox it would be sandbox.hotmogs.com http sandbox.hotmogs.com port number 8020 this could be the value you can end up the property tag similarly for next one it would be name machine 2 sorry it would be dfs dot name node dot rpc address my cluster dot name node 2 with the name value should be machine 2 so these kinds of property that needs to be added similarly for HTTP address also we just need to add the properties for two different name nodes so suppose if we use the property to specify the full qualified HTTP address for each name node to listen on so we just need to set the similar kind of property just need to be added in the HDFS site.xml for HTTP address like same name would be there dfs.namenode.http address then mycluster.namenode1 and value should be the same but address would be different port number would be different for HTTP address it would be 50070 machine1.example.com and it would be 50070 so the property tag would look like property name so that should be the property if you have the Hadoop security features enabled so you just need to set the HTTPS address for each and every name node so instead of HTTP just utilize HTTPS so and next configuration that could be set for DFS name node shared edits directory so we just need to use this property to specify the URI that identifies a group of journal nodes where the name nodes will write and read the edit logs so to configure the addresses of the journal nodes that provide the shared edit storage the active name node writes to the shared storage and the standby name node that would read from the location to stay up to date with all the system changes so although there you must also specify several journal node addresses and that you may configure only those of for the URIs or for the cluster so the URI that should look like for journal nodes as qjournal host 1 that's a host IP port number 1 host 2 port 2 then host 3 port 3 like this slash journal ID so the journal ID would be a unique identifier for the name service which should allow a single set of journal nodes to provide the storage for multiple federated name system and you can reuse the namespace IDs also for the journal identifier for example like the journal nodes if a journal node for the cluster is running in node1.example.com and node2.example.com and node3.example.com for three different nodes so for example for the different machines three different machines and namespace ID where as my cluster so you could use this like you could mention the property as like this property name DFS dot name node dot shared dot edits dot dir name property could be QJournal node 1 dot example.com. Like this way, slash at the end of three cluster, just need to write my cluster, close out the value tag and close the property tag. So just a note, the default port number for journal node is 8485. And a similar kind of configuration is available for dfs.client.failover.proxy.provider. So this property would specify that they are basically the Java class that HDFS client uses to contact with active name node, and DFS client uses these actual Java classes to determine that which name node is currently active, and therefore based on that the name node is currently serving the which are the client request. So we just need to use there the configured failover proxy provider function to implement a implementation that if we are not using a custom implementation. So just need to add for the following set of property. Property name dfs.client.failover.proxy.provider.myCluster's name and value should be org.apache.hadoop HDFS server name node HA configure configured failover proxy provider and then close out the property tag. So these are few configurations that's being there for configuring the name node high available for cluster. And the property is like dfs.ha.fencing method. So this property would specialize if a list of scripts or Java classes that would be used to fence active name node during a failover. So it's typically important for maintaining the correctness of the system that only one of the name node, if it is an active state at any given point of time, especially when using the CoreNum journal manager, or the name node will be ever being allowed to write to the journal nodes itself. So in that, there would be no potential potential for corrupting the file system metadata from a split brain scenario. But whenever a failover occurs, it would still be possible that the previous active name node could serve the read request to the clients, which maybe will be out of date until the name node shuts down while trying to write to the journal nodes. So for that reason, there are some specific recommended configurations being available, like for SSH fence, SSH to the active name nodes and kill the process. And there are some properties being available for this, like dfs.ha.fencing methods. We just need to mention the value as SSH fence. And optionally, you could be able to configure that non-standard username and port number to perform SSH, so that you could be able to configure a timeout in milliseconds for the SSH, and after which the fencing method would be considered as to have been failed. For shell as well, we should be able to run a command, a shell command, to fence the active name node. Like if we have a property dfs.ha.fencing.methods, if we write a value for shell, so it would have slash value slash property. Similarly, the configuration is available for fs.defaultfs. So this is the default path actually this fs.defaultfs. So it's actually user prefix, a path prefix used by Hadoop FS client, and optionally you may now configure the default path for Hadoop clients to use a new high available enabled logical URI. For example, like if I have for my cluster namespace nmservice ID, so then this value would be the value for authority portions of all of your HDFS path. So in that cases, we just need to add the settings in core site.xml. Property name as fs defaults, default fs, value should be htfs my cluster or sandbox.hortonworks.com, like this. For DFS journal node editing directory also, that could be that we need to provide the absolute path for the journal node machines where the edits and local states, like which is typically used by journal nodes, will be stored, and you may be only used to a single path for this configuration, and redundancy for other data that could be provided by either running multiple separate journal nodes or by configuring this directory on the locally attached RAID array. So for that one, DFS dot journal note dot edits dot dir, just need to write property name tfs dot journal note So that's all the following settings that we need to maintain for configuring the name node high availability. The next step is basically for the deploying a name node high available cluster. So in order to deploy the Asia cluster, so for name node 1 to denote the original name node in the non-Asia setup, so a name node 2, suppose that's denote the other name node that's to be added to the high available setup. So what we need to do, we just first need to start the journal node daemons. What we need to, what we can write specifically. I'm deleting this property because I have only a single name node in the single cluster. Next, we need to initialize the journal node at the name node 1 or the name node host machine. Just need to execute the command. So this command will format all the journal notes, and this is by default happens in an interactive way, that the command prompts for the users for the yes and no inputs, that's to confirm the format. And you can skip the prompt by using hyphen force. So since we have used the parameter force or non-interactive, so it doesn't prompt us for yes or no. And it also copies all the edits data after the most recent checkpoint from the edits directories of the local name node to the journal node. So at the host with the journal node, if it is separated from the primary host, we just need to execute this command, that what we have executed, name node initialize a shared edits force. So it would initialize a high availability state in there in HDFS for all the journal nodes. Also, in order to initialize high availability state in ZooKeeper, we just need to execute some command at name node HDFS ZKFC. Format ZK. So basically this command would create a Z node in the ZooKeeper, and the failover system should store the this uses the Z node for the data storage. Just check that if ZooKeeper service is running or not. If it is not, so just we need to start the service first. Looks like ZooKeeper service is not running. So we just need to start the service. It's going to stop all the services actually. So we just need to start the ZooKeeper service, and so then we'd be able to execute the command HDFS ZKFC format ZK with the parameter 4, so that it would initialize a high availability state in ZooKeeper as well. And after that, once a ZooKeeper service has been started at the standby name node host, we could be also able to execute this command, name node bootstrap standby force. So basically this bootstrap standby, that would typically would go ahead and suppose we have in the name node 1 that being started the high availability setup already, and ZooKeeper set a high availability setup is already have been done. So at the when name node 1 has been started at the NN1 host machine, after starting name node, just ensure that NN1 is running correctly, so we can format another name node, and we can copy basically the latest checkpoint, the FS image from the name node 1 to name node 2 by executing this command, that bootstrap standby command. So this command will connect to the HH1 that to get the namespace metadata for the checkpointed FS image, and this command also ensures that the name node 2 would receive the sufficient edit logs from the journal nodes corresponding to the FS image, and this command fails if the journal nodes are not correctly initialized and cannot provide the required edit logs. So just in the name node 2 also, go ahead and start the name node services, and then just start the data node, just validate the HA high availability configurations, and if you just go to the name nodes web pages also separately, so you'd be able to see that the corresponding address level, the HA state is being available for the name node. Name node could be either then must be in standby or in the active status. And finally, if you check the HA name node is being initially in the standby state, and after if it is bootstrapped, so you can check either through JMX to query the high availability state or of a name node. So just can write HTFS HA admin. Get service state. So typically, this command works for the transitions of the high availability name node to the active state. So initially, suppose you have two different name nodes, NN1 and NN2, both are in the standby state. Therefore, you must be able to transition one of the name node in the active state, and this transition can be performed using the following options. Like you can add an optional argument like I hyphen using the CLI. So it's like HTFS, HA admin. You could be able to add the command like this. HTFS. HA admin failover, then force fence, force active, service ID, then name node ID, like this. And another option is being available, that's to configure and deploy the automatic failover. So that is by using the deploying the automatic failover. So this is actually the commands that could be utilized for configuring the deploying a name node high available cluster. And typically the HTFS HA admin get service state, this command would be utilized to query the high availability state for the name node. So if you just go ahead and check, after configuring the high availability, so you'd be able to see that in the name node web portal, name node like for sandbox.hotmails.com or some portal, my cluster 8020. So name node would be by default in the standby state, HA name node initially, it would be standby state after it has been bootstrapped. And also for the version wise, you could also be able to check the JMX status as well. There you can write. Sorry, 134. So it is in the active status. So by default, it could be either enabling the HA. It could be either in active status or it could be in the standby status. And the HA name node initially, it could be in the standby state after it has been bootstrapped. So I have not executed bootstrap, but when it is being the name node directly, it would be in standby or in active state after HA status enablement. But initially, in the standby state, it comes after if it has been bootstrapped, just enabling the shared bootstrap command. You could either utilize then JMX command, typically the HTFS HA admin command hyphen get service state to query the high availability state for the name node. And similar other options, as I said, that using CLI also you could be able to check over there. So these are the specific options to deploy high availability in to deploy a name node with high availability cluster. Similarly, you'd be able to deploy Hue with a high available cluster. Hue is being available from HTTP 2.2 also, that we have been checked that Hue is available in the port number 8000. So in Hue also, it could be configured with an high available cluster, and just we need to execute few commands, yum install Hadoop HTTPFS, and after that you just need to configure HTTPS site.xml, just need to add some properties for proxy user Hue host and Hue groups, just need to restart the service, and in the Hadoop configuration file as well, just I need to add the proxy user HTTPFS groups and the host name, and then we could be able to get the Hue configuration details for high availability. Similarly, we could be able to deploy Uzi as well for high available clusters, like specific for load balancers, for database that supports a multiple connections, Zookeeper that could be also being enabled for high availability. And also there are specific steps is available for operating a name node high available cluster. While operating a name node high available cluster, the active name node, it cannot commit a transaction if it is if it cannot write successfully to an quorum of the journal nodes. When suppose we are going to restart an HA cluster, if the steps for initializing the journal nodes and the name node too that can be skipped, but it should need to start the services in a specific order whenever you are just going to deploy the name node HA cluster for operating. That first one is the you just need to start the services in this order, that's journal node, and then need to start the name nodes, and third needs to start the data nodes. So it's the same configuration if you are working for a few hundred nodes for production for masters and slave, or we are working for 1,000 nodes for masters and slave in the production. Just verify once that you have the ZK failover controller, ZKFC Zookeeper process on each and every node is running, so that one of the name node can be converted to an active state whenever it's required. Also, you could be able to configure and deploy a name node automatic failover. This is a pretty much configuring step. So I think the name node automatic failover, I would provide a document for this, that specifically it should consist of some workflow and diagrammatic information like automatic failover that which adds the following components on HDFS deployment, like Zookeeper, Quorum, ZK failover controller process. The Zookeeper failover controller ZKFC is a Zookeeper client that monitors and manages the state for the name node, and each of the machine would run typically that name node services that could run the ZKFC. So ZKFC is typically being responsible for health monitoring, for session management, and for Zookeeper-based elections. So what I will do, I will provide the document, and the instructions should be also been there in this document. Specific configuration is needed to provide an HDFS site.xml, and also there is some specific configurations available for Uzi failovers as well. So I will provide a document on this name node automatic failover. So these are the basic things that we need to go for the certification as well, typically for as course-wise information. So that is pretty much about what we have in this course regarding name node high availabilities, configurations, deployment of name node HA clusters. What we will do next is next Monday we'll meet maybe for just an hour, and I would check if you have any specific questions, queries or concerns regarding the entire course, and also if there is anything specific hands-on or demo if it is messed up, or if, which if I think that I need to show up also, so I could check, and I would do in that day. So next Monday probably would be the wrap-up class that we can go for the session, and I could also provide the specific documents of the demos that we did. These are the most important things, each and every topic, like operating a name node HA cluster, then also enabling the Kerberos security principles, and also the rack awareness configurations of Hadoop cluster. So I'll provide each and every documents that could be all HortonWorks authorized documents. Just make sure that when you are performing the hands-on, the specific location of the components. Like in many old documents for HTTP cluster, you may be able to find that the information to be mentioned as the Hadoop daemons shell that's being present in user LIV, that particular directory. But for HTTP 2.2 onwards, the location has been changed. So just make sure that when you are performing the hands-on, the directories and the corresponding resources as being there in the correct directory you are being accessing. So otherwise, if you are going through and checking through the old document, in that cases you will face errors. Alright guys, so I think we can wrap up here for today. So as I mentioned, Monday will be the final class for the session, and first of all I will check up with you if you have any specific questions or queries for this entire course. Please go through the documents and please go through the sessions recordings. If you have any specific questions, concerns, queries, we could be able to discuss. And also if there is any specific demos, hands-on or documents that I need to provide, I will discuss on that same day. Alright then, so we can wrap up today here.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah, Anandita, anything like, you know, questions or any material that you could provide in, related to the administration exam?
This all are related to the administration exam, whatever we covered in this course.
Yeah, it means like, you know, do you have any questions?
Oh, you mean question?
Yeah.
Question, actually it's very specific because Hortonworks doesn't allow anyone to have the questions, and I don't think so any dumps is there, because when I give exam, I just gone through the syllabus and the course and specifically the Hortonworks documents. What you can do, you after going through all the materials, after your preparation, you can go for, there is a mock exam facility is there for Hortonworks. You can register for the mock exam, and that would be same like just like a real-time exam, administration exams, and you can apply for that. It's free, of course, your mock exam, web-based, online. So same question, same, the question pattern that could be same, sections would be same. So just go for the mock exam. What I can do, I could provide you the link for the mock exam. You guys need to register for that exam and just can practice with that. It's free.
Okay, that would be great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sure.
Okay, thank you, Anandita.
Okay, thanks.
Have a good night.
Yeah. Thanks, everyone. Have a nice weekend. Bye.
You too. Thanks.